All right, I think I'm set up. I have audio recording there. I have video here and a little picture in picture. And I think everything's ready to go. So, hi, welcome to my little series. It's going to be Marlin Firmware Working with GitHub. How do we do it? And what are some shortcuts that make it a little easier to do? So, I've got a few, and I'm going to try and demonstrate them. Rather than overtax the processor here, I'm going to take the picture-in-picture and eventually drop it out because it just makes the fan run. But for the time being, hi. So let me get rid of this. Just wanted to have a title. There we go. And let's begin at the beginning. So most of the work that I do is in the editor, of course, but also in the terminal. There is a command line that you can get to if you have a non-Unix or Linux version of GitHub desktop. So you right-click on the name of the repository in the left sidebar, and it pops up a window or a menu that says, open command line. And so just go there, and then you can do all the Git commands you can do there. I have scripts that I'm going to show that are actually require Unix or Linux, a bash shell. Well, actually, you can, as long as you have something like Sigwin in Windows, you can do it. It involves probably simple commands like awk and sed. So if you have a regular GNU command line installed on your Windows, you can actually do all of these things, which are really handy shortcuts, and I'll show you them as I go. I'm just going to give you an initial sort of intro to what I'm using to do all the work that I do as I go along. So let's begin at the beginning. Obviously, I use a few different things. I have Terminal, of course. Right now, I'm recording the screen with QuickTime. GitHub Desktop is open. I have a couple browsers because I need to deal with issues. And I have Sublime Text, which is my primary editor. And in Sublime, I have installed up here, and I don't know if I can zoom the screen and actually record it, but let's see if it does. Dev IoT, and Dev IoT is pretty cool. It actually has a lot of what you need to do any kind of building. So you have, there's your build, your upload, your clean, all the stuff you would need for doing building, and it's basically it's platform IO, so that's what's going on with that. So when you want to build something, you just basically, here I've got Marlin main open. I can actually demonstrate this really quickly. Option or Alt DB, and boom, opens up, and there it goes. And this is a bit quicker than running over to Arduino IDE every time, and just have to make sure you have the right configuration that you want to build for, and that your options are set. And out comes the output. It's pretty good, and it's about as quick as Arduino IDE. I timed them together, and they're comparable, maybe 1 second apart sometimes. But yeah, they're running, and I think it basically is using the same tool set, so it should be. It's fast. And there you go. Success. 32.5 seconds or 32. 0.15, and the basic build, there you go. It takes only 52k and leaves lots of data free. So, okay. So that's my environment for that. And of course, I like using this editor because, you know, it's very quick to do almost anything. If you want to look for the word firmware, you know, everywhere, just boom, there it is. And you can very quickly, you know, find things and edit them. It's just got a very, it's got a quicker turnaround than some editors that are trying to do everything at once. So, let's see, apart from my editing, let's see, of course, in GitHub Desktop, do all kinds of things in here. Right now I have RC bug fix open, and you can see here's all the recent commits up to 2 days ago. And I haven't made any changes to this branch because I never do. I recommend that if you have, when you make your fork of Marlin, don't ever change the branch that's the work branch, or the branch that you're going to be making PRs for. Make a copy of that branch instead. You know, use a new branch, and it'll make a copy from the branch you're working on currently. And you should always start from a fresh copy of RC bug fix. I have some scripts, and I'll show you those actually next. So let me pull up my bin folder. And I actually have, these are inside of the Marlin package, but I've installed them in my local bin folder for convenience. And you can see, I used to be in a band called Space Lord. And so we all named our accounts Lord something, and it's never gone away. So, but sometimes I feel a bit lordish. So anyway, I have here my all the commands that I've written for the purpose of making things run. If I'm in a, I can show you what they basically do. MFinfo, if I type that, it just tells me about the current branch that I'm in. So if I'm in this, and you can see I'm in my command line, I actually have it show me the name of the current branch that I'm in, and that's just a little add-on for the command line. Really easy thing to do in my dot profile. So if you need to find out more about that, you can always ask me on the channel. I'll try and find the link. But anyway, so this just shows you, here's the repository that's the root repository, in this case, RE Upstream, Marlin Firmware. Here's the branch, the fork that I'm in, that's my account up on GitHub. Then there's the actual name of the repository, Marlin, and that's going to be the same all the time. We used to have Marlin Dev, and I actually had a reason for this MF info needed to return different info for Marlin Dev versus Marlin, which is why it came to exist in the first place. But it's useful because as we change branches, the script can change to adapt to our new work environment. So now there's the branch that I'm in, RC bug fix. I think it's the last one would be RC bug fix is the branch I'm in. If I was in a different branch, let's pick one. Git checkout another branch. This one. Pardon. So if I check that one out now, if I go mfinfo, it should show that one. Yeah, there it is. So this would be the branch, RC bug fix would be the branch that I should be making pull requests to, and that's why it shows up here. And then this would be the branch I'm in. So mfinfo is used by the other scripts to figure out what they should be communicating with as far as the upstream on GitHub and stuff. MF init just that actually creates the upstream that points to Marlin firmware, and it's just useful to have a remote name. I should say it creates a remote. And the remote, if I show you my git remote, show you these are remotes that I currently have. I'm pointing to different accounts. I have the one Marlin firmware, of course. I have Bob, who I've been working with a lot. And we have my origin, which would be your fork is always named origin. So when you make a fork, you'll always have that. Upstream is my alias to Marlin firmware. And upstream is just a convenience, but it's used a lot. So I just make it by default. And that's what MF init does up here. I've been working with yhfoodev. So all these are different users who have forks of Marlin. And I have basically made these remotes that are just that allow me to pull down their changes into a little pool area, and then I can check out those changes from that pool into branches that are just within my own repository that point to their commits, and then I can use those branches to build off of, and then I can make pull requests that actually go to their forks. So that's why we have it's useful to be able to create remotes and pull in other users. And if I do the more detailed thing, you can see it's like, this is the actual URL that GitHub uses or that Git uses to figure out how to talk to the upstream remote, and whether it uses it for fetch and push. They're always, for the most part, we're always going to use fetch and push on all remotes. And that's pretty much what that's about. Let me go back to those scripts again. And here we have, okay, so next is mfnew. And mfnew, that's a simple one. All it does is makes a copy of your RC bugfix branch as a new branch. And if you're in the middle of working on something in the branch that you're in currently, it'll just not do it because it'll say, oh, you have unsaved changes, and it'll warn you. So it's a way, it's just a convenient way for starting a new branch. And that's what I use to just start a new branch. If I'm not, in fact, most of the time I just use mfnew rather than even using GitHub Desktop. There's also mfpr, that actually creates a pull request, and I can give you a quick demo of that. If I say mfpr, it looks at my, it figures out from mfinfo, my current branch, and it opens up the browser. Well, first it figures out whether it needs to upload it, and it says this one, I haven't uploaded this one yet. So it's uploading it, and now it brings me to the compare changes page. So that's just a really handy way to very quickly, you can see this isn't ready to go because it's old and stale. But, you know, this is a case where you might update it and then bring it in. But, yeah, this was actually a concept I had, which was like, hey, maybe if we use a, we could come up with a printf command that does serial, it would be, you know, make the code smaller and the string smaller. But every time I did something, it just got bigger and bigger. So I'm throwing this concept away. But this is a good example of, like, something that is a little old and it won't merge. It isn't ready to go. And I'll give some demo on how to clean that up in a bit. So here we have, so you can see a couple more scripts. mfprune figures out which things I've already merged and just basically prunes my current branches. So if I send mfprune, it'll figure out, hey, here's some merged branches, and there aren't any at the moment. Here's the ones you deleted from your own fork that you haven't deleted locally yet. And it'll actually prune those for me. And usually that's what I want. I don't often delete things from the GitHub interface, but if I do, that's pretty much what I want to happen. And then you do too, I guess, because I made this script for everybody. Anyway, git branch d, then it just tells me you might want to remove these remote tracking references because you're not using them anymore. So I'll actually do that. Okay, so next one is mfpub, and that's used for the documentation, so I won't talk about that yet. Mfdoc over here, which I didn't mention either, is also part of that. So those are both part of the Marlin documentation fork or repository, and those deal with one just like shows it to me in the browser, and then another one actually publishes the changes to the website in a nice, neat packaged way. And then, okay, so then we have QP. I kind of forget what that is right now. I made it recently, but I'll just print it out and see what it is. And it is, right, add all changed files, commit as patch. Oh, it's a quick push thing, yeah. Quick patch, so basically MFQP, all that does is adds everything that's been changed. Like if I've made a bunch of changes to files, it'll git add them. It'll then git commit them with just the name patch, and then it runs to and then it goes to git rebase, so that I can make changes and to the order or whatever of commits. I can tweak the commits. I can squash them. I can do other things from git rebase interactive, which again I'll show you the interactive rebase as well. So let's see what we have here. That is that one. MFRB. Okay, MFRB is my quick. Basically, it does. Again, I'll show you what the code looks like. It is. It does a git rebase I against the target branch, whether it's RC bugfix or when we were using Marlin dev, it was a dev branch. And it just basically does a git rebase to the. Naming either basically the root commit of before your new commits. So if I type it now, you can see my commits will pop up. There they are. Okay, so it pops up. In my case, I'm using Joe editor. Some people might use VI or other editors, but I use Joe. And here you can see, like, here's the three things, and it gives instructions. You know, pick them, reword them, edit them, squash them. And squash is interesting. You use commit but meld into previous commit. I usually use fix up. It just doesn't keep the log message, because usually what I want to do is have, I'll usually have one that's like a few that are, I'll start out with a few that are like, I did this and this and this, and then I'll basically create one that says, here's a bunch of changes that go together. And if they didn't go together, you wouldn't want them anyway. So it makes sense in most cases. The best times to squash commits are when you have a bunch of changes that go together and wouldn't make sense without being together. Or if you want to have a bunch of commits that, I knew what I was going to say a second ago. But yeah, they either they go together or they don't make sense otherwise. Or they're just like, you know, little things and you just want to like, you know, group them. Anyway, what I have here now is, let's see, I've got a few. So say if I wanted to do this one, I would just say fix up and this commit would go away and become part of this commit with this name, with this title on it. If I used S, it would keep both of these titles, or both of these descriptions, both of these commit messages. So anyway, I don't want to do anything, so I'm just going to delete all three lines and exit. Okay, so that's those, and we'll go back to those scripts again. And what's left is MF remote, and that just is another quick one that I just created recently that just lets me create a remote very quickly. So I can say MF remote, and I just name the GitHub account whose fork I want to create a remote for. So I might say, let's see, boxy-3d, and it would create a remote and grab all of her latest changes. Now I have all these, and if I want to make a branch, say out of, I don't know, let's pick one. Let's say WBL is when you're working on a lot. So I might say git checkout. And I might just copy this, and then say new branch, and I'll give it an RC prefix for convenience, and just say more UBL stuff. And I might, and now I have a branch that I'm working on, and it doesn't point anywhere yet. This is just a branch in my, it's just in my local repository, in my working copy. So if I want to have it be in my upstream on my fork, and then which makes it available to make a pull request, I can push it up there by using, I made another command called first push, and that just sends it upstream, sends it to my origin or my, you know, my thinky head fork of Marlin, and now there's a branch that's been uploaded and it's set to track it. And if I do git branch dash V, and you can see double V. There's that one. Oh, that branch is here, and you can see it's set to point to origin more UBL stuff. The good thing is I might be going quickly, but this is a video, so you can rewind and replay, and even have it go slow. So hopefully that'll help you keep up. And I just wanted to have this documented as well, for those who need it. Okay, what else before I get too far afield? So now I've got that pushed, and so you can see I go back to GitHub Desktop, there's my branch, look at the history, look at all that, look at all those commits. Now let's say I wanted to take this branch, which is, this wouldn't be a good example because we've just done lots of changes, but say I wanted to take a branch that hasn't been updated in a while, and say it's a pull request, and I need to bring it up to date with the latest RC bug fix. How can I do that? How can I get everything up to date so that it's set up? So generally, you could do git merge, which would bring in all the changes, and they basically end up after your commits. And this is okay if you don't really plan to make any more changes. But I find it, but the thing is, I find it a little messy. It tends to creates a merge commit, which is another piece of clutter in history, and it's just it tends to just be out of order. And usually you want, like, here's my new feature on top of the code. And you want that to sort of, like, as it sits waiting to be accepted, it should be sort of like, here's the code that goes on the code that's there. And so you want to have it sort of be the commits should really be at the end of, you know, everything else. Sometimes there are pull requests that sit for a long time, and they don't end up with any kind of conflict. And those are fine because, you know, they're making changes to things that haven't been changes in a while, or they're just not changing things that are, you know, getting in the way of other things. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to rebase everything, but if you find something that does say it's got conflicts, that's a good time to rebase it. So let's pick one, actually, now, and see what we can find. So I'll go to pull requests from Marlin. And here we have, let's see, oh, am I, I'm not looking at the right project. I just went to the top level pull requests. And, okay, so we have 46 open. Now, I'm not going to start at the top. Let's start down here. Say, bed cycle, MM600, how's that holding up? Is that, it's got conflicts. So let's do this. We could resolve conflicts here on using the resolve conflicts button. And that can work fine sometimes. I haven't messed with it lately, but here's how that works. Okay, one conflict, and you just go to it. And I think if I scroll the screen up, it'll actually have it on there. The editor is sized to the window, I think. Not taking account of the scrolling. So here we have a typical type of conflict. This means that in the RC bug fix branch, it looks like this, and this commit named, or in the branch, RC M600 temp bed, it looks like this. And both of them have been changed is what's going on, and we want to figure out which one should be kept, or whether they need to be both sort of massaged so that they both fit together. So let's see what's been changed here. We have, let me see, set target item is the same. Okay, so here's nozzle timed out and elapsed. Nozzle timeout millis. What's been massaged here is that I think the current MS was removed, and these two ifs were combined into one if. So that's how it is in RC Bugfix, and this particular pull request changed it in some other way, probably for the nozzle timed out or something like that. So let's take a look at how it's changed. It added the bed. So I think that's what's going on. So let's take the new code and stick it in to where the current code, or I should say the pull request code into the, based on the old code, gets merged in with the new code. And let's see if there's any other changes that are important here. And I think that's it. Okay, so good. So that actually resolves it. So now we'll just remove that. And now this is compliant with the current code. And so now I can say, great, it's marked as resolved. So that was an easy one. So, and I will now commit that. I'm not sure, I guess I'm still on the fence of whether to accept this one. It cools the bed when you're changing the filament, and that actually could be problematic because things will pull off the bed. So we'll wait and see on that one. Maybe there's a better example where it's more messy and I'll have to go through a more complicated process. And that'll give you a better idea of the complicatedness that you can really do without actually getting lost. So maybe, I should pick one that's a little trickier. Maybe this old one, pins debug with more features, uses less RAM. That's a pretty complex one, I think. Let me see. Well, one commit, two files changed. I'm pretty sure it's still okay. Okay, well, that one's fine. Let's wait on that. I need to find one that's I should have picked one earlier before I started this, but let's see. How about I don't know, RGB LED strip support? Let's take a look at that one. Okay, so here I've asked for a bunch of changes. There's been many comments, and apparently there's now a lot of conflicts, mainly with the configuration files, which is pretty common. Something ended up in the same area or whatever. So what we'll do is, what I have to do is now, I don't have a copy of this, so I'm going to get it. So now, this is Bo Weevil, is the name of this guy, and he's working off a copy of RC, or he's working off of RC Bugfix, which he made a copy of in his fork. So I'm going to get his Bo Weevil, and I would use, in my case, MF add Bo Weevil, that makes a new remote, and pulls it in, and now I will check out his Bo Weevil RC Bugfix branch, and I'll call it, what was the feature? RLED, okay, so RGB, RC, RGB, LED, boom. Okay, so now I've made a new branch out of his work. I haven't uploaded it to my fork yet. I just have a copy of it that's in my working copy. And you can look at the commits and the history, and you can see that the last thing that it's based on is like 3 months ago. So this is going to be a lot of changes probably given away. So now what I would do is I would say git rebase RC bugfix. And this just tells it to try to take these commits out, put all the commits, basically bring me the latest RC bugfix that you have. And in my case, I have one from a couple days ago. I could update that also. But for now, I'm just going to use the one I have. And because it's pretty recent, certainly more than, closer than 2 months. And then his commits will be, they'll attempt to put Bo Weevil's commits again at the end of RC bugfix. So let's do that and see what happens. Rewinding. Oh, we ran into a conflict right away. Rebase 1/3, and we'll see that hopefully the my command line add-on is even showing like the messages that come from Git. So when you go to ask for its branch, it'll actually return this message and say you're on a rebase. So my command line is telling me right away. I totally recommend this one if you have a batch. So anyway, now what I need to do is go to my editor and find out where those conflicts are. I assume that they're going to be inside the Marlin folder, which is what I'm looking at now. If they're a little, if they're at one higher level, I won't find them this way. So I need to also check that. But when I go to try to commit the changes, it'll actually tell me, hey, you need to add stuff that you haven't added yet. And then I know, oh, there must be stuff in the folder above Marlin. So now, here are our conflicts. I looked for four less than signs, and that takes me to all the that shows me all the conflicts pretty quickly. So now I double-click in this editor to take me to the first conflict. What's going on? Well, in card reader, apparently, enable this LED strip.h was added for some reason. It's included here, and I'm going to assume that it has something to do with turning on the colors. And then this longest file name is also apparently added because they're both here. So the thing is, in his, it isn't existing, and in mine it does, which means it was added later. So that gives you a clue. Head means basically this is let me see. Head is right at the end of RC bugfix, I presume. So here we go. So that's how that gets resolved. The next one is down here. And here you can see I've added a sorting feature for SD cards recently. And he's also added LED strip stuff. And it can't figure out whether they go together or whether there are changes. So I'm going to say they both belong here. So basically all these little markers come out. But everything else stays. And this goes away. It was needed. So you can see, sometimes it's hard to tell why things are there, but I can basically explain, I think this is here because, I don't know, I guess it doesn't count the spacing or something. I don't know. But anyway, those definitely go together. And this should, I know what it is also. It can't tell that the two endifs are actually meant to be two different endifs. That's another thing. And while you're doing this stuff, you can actually neaten up the code. Just make it whatever you want. Like if I wanted to add this up here, like, oh, let's do that so it's clear that that's not part of the if or something like that. I could do that and just make it part of this. So, okay, a little bit of neatening on here. That resolves everything. So now it's only in one file. If I say git add now, there you go. I just hit tab and it knows which ones I should be adding because git's smart that way. And now I say git rebase continue. And that'll basically take what I've added and assume that it's good and keep going. Let's see. Okay, now we have another conflict on the next commit. There's, I think, three altogether, so we're going to probably, I don't even really count them, but once again, we look for those, and look, there's only one. It's in Marlin main again. And, oh, it's a rather big change. So, you can see here, it starts there. I'm looking for the little equal signs where it ends. Where is it? Something, so sometimes it's it can be a little weird. Why does it think this huge addition is like, you know, something worth pointing out? Anyway, let me go back to the change over here. So here's head. Let's just collapse these. I know that some of this, that a lot of this stuff has changed recently. So it's been, well, 3 months. A 3 month old pull request is bound to have stuff like this. So I'm just going to hide these. Until I get to, wow, the end of where it thinks it should be. Okay. Since the equal signs that I'm looking for are going to be in the left column, the collapsing should be broken by that. So it should, it's probably, does this go all the way to the end of the file or something? This is crazy. Well, let's find those equals, four equal signs. Wow, they're way down here. Okay, so that's peculiar. All I can say is that clearly that's, you know, all this code belongs, I'm pretty sure. But in the what this means here is the name of the commit message that was given in the Weebles branch is update Marlin main CPP, which is not a very descriptive commit, but what was changed was just apparently this link was added. So as I look at this, I just want to make sure that it's all good. Yeah, because clearly we don't want to remove the loop and stuff like that. The other thing to check would be, you know, are there two copies of void loop or something like that? So I'm just checking to make sure it didn't get very confused. And apparently it didn't. So let's go back to our four less thans. And we'll just presume that this is all fine. And the other thing is we can always go back. We have all the data is still available if we need to figure out what's really going on. But I think that is correct. So now we'll just go back to here. And again, in this case, Marlin main. And now we rebase continue again. Voila. And oh, the third one has some conflicts, which is, I guess, we expected. We were going to expect conflicts in those configuration files. So once again, looking for those, and we'll find probably many. Yeah. And this may be, it looks like it's going to be very tricky to resolve this, because this, a lot has changed. But I'll give it a quick effort just to see if it's something simple. There's another way to approach this, which is to just look at the individual commits and figure out what changes should be applied to the new code, and then just do it by hand. And oftentimes that's better than trying to resolve a lot of very confusing stuff. If you do go to GitHub desktop at this point, it's in an intermediate state. You can see it's actually saying you were there were conflicting changes, and you're in the middle of doing stuff. You can resolve them, mature them. So that's kind of what's going on now. And resolve. So Let me see if there's anything that I can solve here. Yeah, this looks a little too big to get into, I think. I can see what's going on. So, we changed the bilinear subdivision stuff changed. Let's go to another one. This is the next conflict, and it's looking at like really large again bilinear subdivision. So what I would tend to do in this case would be to do like a side by side comparison. There's another tool I use, which I'll probably bring up later in another video, which is BB Edit. Let's take this. Let's drop this particular endeavor. This is obviously 3 months is a long time. So what I will do is git rebase abort, which will put the branch back in the state where we started. You can actually see that GitHub desktop, but it's back in its original 3 months ago, and then here come these three commits. And some of them are probably, I don't know, like that one shouldn't even be there. You're not supposed to change Marlin configuration in a pull request. You're supposed to make new configurations or whatever if you need to demonstrate stuff. And so there's a bunch of stuff here that I wouldn't keep. It needs to be redone anyway. So let's move on. And look, here's 55 changes in one. This is a case also where you would split things up. Sometimes I'll split up something into more than one commit. If it's configurations in one, and then I'll take the code changes and put them in another. Reason being that usually the configuration changes are all identical, and they just get, and you can put them beforehand, and it doesn't hurt anything because nobody's going to enable that stuff yet, and it doesn't matter if the code isn't there. And then, the next thing you're going to have, next commit, you can just look at the code. You don't have to have all those other things there. You can just look at the commit that includes the code and not the commit that includes all of the configurations. The same with languages. I would probably split this up into three or whatever. And there are ways to do that, too. Like I can, because I'm here working where I am, like the fact that RC Bugfix has moved on doesn't matter. I'm at this point in history when I'm in this branch. So if I decide that I want to mess with this this last commit, I can actually do that. I can undo it or something, or I could split it up. I could take I could do a diff, for example, and there are other good tricks. That's one that I often do. Like I'll take something like, let's go to this point in time and figure out how it differs from the latest, and I can say, okay, well, copy this. This is the commit number. And I'll go, okay, let's git diff, or we'll check that actually out. Git check out that particular commit as a new branch. We'll call it rebuild RGB. Right? And I would just, this is just one way to do it. But this is a branch, now I have a new branch that's based on that commit, and we go back to RGB. Here you can see, but there we are at that point in time. That's where we are. Oops. Okay, and now, now if I say git diff, the branch I'm in, and there's probably another way to do this, but, and then I say branch that I'm looking for, and then I say git apply. This is going to do some regret. All the code is going to be reverted to 3 months ago as well. So this is not the best way to do it, but git apply there. Now it happened. Now I have 53 uncommitted changes, and I could go and I can cherry pick through all of this and say, I want to keep this. I want to keep that. I want to keep that. This is something maybe I want to. This is something he's added. This has nothing to do with RGB LED, right? So obviously something that I don't want to keep. It must be something that was removed. But sometimes even though things are green, it doesn't mean it's good. It means like these things that are here in green, basically it's opposite world. Once you do a diff, all the things that were removed will be in green, plus all the things that are added will be in green. And you have to differentiate between them. So here is RGB strip. So maybe this is supposed to be here. And you know, here's again another RGB strip based thing. And here's something that's been commented out. Maybe that's important. Set LED color. We'll keep that. We'll keep that. And so you can kind of pick through, and that obviously has nothing to do with it. So one of the major things clearly that changed was this bilinear subdivision stuff. So you know, I could go through and I could cherry pick all this and just say, okay, these are gone. These are all gone, but the things I'm keeping are the RGB stuff. And I could make a commit based on that if I decided first to turn all these off. But like, you know, and same thing here, you know, I would go through and start out with everything unselected and then go through and actually select them instead. Again, something going from something that's 3 months old is harder. It's definitely going to be harder, and that's why it's good to. I try to keep things not getting too stale. Looks like most of the stuff in the configuration is fine. These are all things that are bilinear subdivision related again. So these are all going away. I could basically say, okay, these obviously have nothing to do with RGB LED strips. So I can select these. I obviously don't want any changes in these unless they have something to do with RGB LED strip support, and that doesn't. And maybe I don't want to throw away everything over here yet. So here's the RGB LED strip stuff. So let's wait on throwing everything on that one away. But everything else here, like, these are all, these have nothing to do with anything. So just, and so. I guess we've got to sell the configs. Oh, it is. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm going to say discard changes to those. Don't need them. Which gives us just the language files now. And what's going on here? Again, that's nothing. That has nothing to do with RGB LED. Apparently nothing related to RGB LED was added to the language files. Right? Tell me I'm right. Okay, yes. And it's good. So I'm going to say none of these language file changes has anything to do with RGB LED. So gone, gone, gone. Oh, wait, there's lights on. Hold on. I saw it a second ago. Right? Did you see it? Did you see it like I saw it? Heavens. Heavens to Betsy. I know I did see it. Well, okay, we won't worry about it, but because we can always go back and compare and make sure and bring it back in if we need to, like later on. Okay, here we go. So that's LED strip stuff. Okay, so what I'm doing right now, I can't remember what I'm doing, is I'm discarding the changes to those language files because they're not related in any way to RGB LED strip. Right? Right. So that's one other way. So we'll discard those. And you notice they have a restore discarded changes option in case you did something that you didn't want to. Find missing translations. Obviously, I don't want to revert that. I don't want to bring back board 99. Let's see. So this is something I actually want to keep because it is the removal of board 99. And that is something that is good. So I'm going to remove board 99. And this is actually a new commit. Okay, what else do I want to keep? Let's see. I don't want to keep anything in here, obviously. That stuff, that I do. So that's more RGB LED strip stuff. Well, right now I should be looking for stuff that I want to get rid of. So changes to version, no. I don't want to keep those. Changes to this LCD stuff, reversions, I should say. I guess those are kept, obviously. That's something I want to keep, I guess. Well, that makes sense. Okay, something else that I want to keep, I guess. Oh, you know, it occurs to me that actually, because I'm doing this comparison to 3 months ago, like, I want to keep a lot of this stuff. But the reason that I'm doing the stuff that I am doing, and like, throwing away the stuff that has nothing to do with the RGBLAD script stuff, is that it gives me clean commits, and then maybe I can rebase those on RC bug fix. So that's the next thing I'm going to try. So that's something that I should have kept. I think that makes sense. I'm throwing this away because it's something that I'm going to get when I do the rebase. So I'm throwing anything away here. Yes, I'm throwing all this away too. The RGBLAD strip stuff here I want to keep, so I'm not throwing everything away there yet. So we'll see what happens. What you do is you commit the stuff that you want to keep, then you do the discarded changes afterward. So here we go. That I'm going to keep, so not yet. And this I'm going to throw away. Okay, so there we go. Discard changes to those, because those are, again, not RGBLAD scripts. Now we're getting to the stuff I actually do want to keep. Go down to the bottom here. We'll keep those, okay, because that's his changes. We'll get that. Not the bilinear stuff. La la la. Okay, that's RGB related, clearly. That's RGB and printer. He made something called printer event LEDs. That's cool. This is related. You can see here, not only says heating complete, but it changes the colors. And then again, here's some more. Okay, so this is actually turning out to be pretty easy to clean up. I guess he commented those out. And there we go. That's kept. Bilinear stuff, skip. We'll get that after. Okay. And I think that's good. In the planner, that's stuff that we're going to get when we do the rebase, so I'll throw that out in a minute. Okay, and he wants to add these two RGB LED strip files. Okay, so that's all being kept. And you can see I've cherry-picked a couple, and I've got a couple whole hog commits. So now we're going to keep those, and I'll just type it in. RGB LED strip support. And there we go. Now I've actually rebuilt everything. And everything else that's left over, we're going to throw away. Discard these changes. Okay, now, when you look at the history, you can see I've got a little bit of a mess. Remove board 99 is actually not what I want to keep. So what I'm going to do is do a real quick, how do I get rid of this commit just by itself? You can't do it from GitHub Desktop, as far as I know. So what I'll do is I'm going to go to the command line, and I'm going to say, Git rebase interactively starting from the base commit. That would be the two commits I did, and then we'll take the one before the first one that I did. And that's the ID that I'm using. And I'm just going to go here, and I'm going to actually just delete this commit. And now if I exit here, it will just be gone. Rebase, done. Okay, so now I have everything ready. It's a perfect thing. Now the only thing I need to do is do Git, here's the tricky part, bug fix. Now it's going to take that one commit and try to put it on RC bug fix as it is now, as it exists today. Let me get the very latest. I'll do it that way. Git, fetch, upstream, make sure we have all the links. Stuff from Marlin Firmware, upstream. Good. Okay, and now I just do a quick git checkout RC bug fix. Git merge upstream RC bug fix. And this is how you keep RC bug, your local RC bug fix, up to date forever. Let's just do that. Now I'll go back to the other branch, git checkout, rebuild, and git rebase RC bug fix. And here we go. Hope it works. Oh, I can't handle it. There's something conflicting. Still, not a big deal. Let's find out what it is. It's in card reader. I think it's that other change we looked at before. Yep, there it is. It's this one. When in card reader, we want to have some RGB strip codes. So, you know. And do I really need log this binary? Let's make sure. Yeah, I guess I do. So save that. And that resolves that. So let's say git rebase or git add a reader, git rebase continue. And it should be done. Perfect. Now, how do we get this code up to that pull request? Well, we can't. We can't actually get that pull request completely replaced unless we can cajole the original author into replacing his commits with my commits and then uploading them. So what I'm just going to do is create a pull request, and here's MFPR, I get to demo this again. And I could use the button in GitHub Desktop, actually, but it wouldn't bring me to the right place because our default branch is RC. This always brings me to RC bug fix, and there we go, right away. RGB LED strip support. Great. Okay, so let's close that. And let's go back to that RGB LED strip support and find the number. Okay, good. And usually what I like to do is just say, make sure that they look together. Rebase and squash of this. Now, I notice I haven't finished it. I have to update the other configs, and I'll do a real quick demo of that. And then we'll be done with this video, and edit it, and we'll see what I can do for the next one. Alright, so here we go. Label. I like to put labels on things. This is a new feature, basically. And let's say it's also LCD, I guess. So, I don't know. Is it a controller thing? UI thing? I guess it is. So whatever. Rebase and squash of 5395. There we go. Great pull request. Boom. Okay, I've rebuilt it using. In this case, as you can see, that was a rather roundabout way to do it, but that is one way to do it. And you actually you have to keep in mind what that you are kind of going back. In that case, I was going forward in time and back in time potentially, because his changes were made against old code. So maybe he had changes that don't pertain to things now. And the Travis test here will catch some of that. But it's done. It hasn't completed yet. The other changes were related to, just stuff that's been done in the last 3 months. And apparently most of it was resolvable, but all that other stuff. So you're actually going forward in time with that stuff. And so the question is, do I want to add that stuff to the commits for this particular feature? Obviously not. They're already in that, so don't fix. It would only create confusion, so I have to very carefully cherry-pick. If things are close together, it might be hard to cherry-pick them, like something that's related to another commit. It can be hard to cherry-pick exactly what you want, but most of the time, things are divided up pretty well, and you can do that. So that was an interesting process. I do that somewhat often, that type of commit this, then throw away the changes, this whole file I don't need, throw away the changes. And then eventually I have something that sometimes it's like many commits and I have to squash them. And you can see like maybe there's some stuff in here that I would like to fix. I think I saw an if parentheses with no space and that annoys me. So let's fix that. Why? And then, here's another one. Why this? Here, just put it once. It's a style thing, whatever. Just like it this way. And look, we're not even changing them, so make them fonts. Just for our own sake, just because it is. Or you could even do this kind of thing and just say, why bother with intermediaries? Just do this. Who needs intermediaries? So you can do that if you want, whichever. And we'll find that other if. And if. Any others? Those are okay. Okay, so now let's go and commit that one uncommitted change. You can see there it is. I'm just going to call it patch. And then I'll go back to here. I'll say MFRB, which is the same as git rebase dash I RC bug fix. Here's my patch. Let's make it part of the other commit by using fixup, exit. There, now we have one commit. And let's update our pull request. and our forks branch at the same time. Boom, there it goes, and now you'll see it'll pop up. Oh, hey, here's a new commit with a new number on it, and the old one is going to not be there when I reload the page. There, it's gone. So you can replace entire, like I could replace this with an entirely different branch if I wanted to. I could go and say, for example, git reset, well, let's go back to the original RGBL that I made. Git checkout. IC, I think it was called RGBLD, yeah, believable. I could, now that I've fixed it up, why don't I do this? Git, you know, I can say git reset hard and have it now contain the same commits as this. Boom. And now you can see that they are identical. This now has, you know, oops. Update for them. So this GitHub desktop is a little glitchy in the display department that's going on. It's kind of a little slow. Okay. I'm just going to wait. There we go.